Dr. Nicholas Green. I am a professor of anesthesiology emeritus at Yale University. Today it is my special honor and privilege to interview a distinguished anesthesiologist from overseas, Dr. Torsten Gord, who is professor of anesthesiology emeritus at the Karolinska Institute and at the Karolinska Hospital in Stockholm, Sweden. This interview is being done on behalf of the Wood Library Museum of Anesthesiology and its series of tapes entitled Living History. This is being taped in Tampa, Florida in March of 1992 during the meeting of the American Society of Regional Anesthesia. It is a particular pleasure and a special honor, Torsten, to interview you because of my many, many years of acquaintance with you and my many, many years of recognition for all that you have been good enough to contribute to our specialty, both here in North America and in Scandinavia and indeed in Europe. It is a pleasure to have you with us.
Thank you.
Why don't we start at the beginning? The better for our audience and our viewers to understand the background of where you came from and therefore how you came about to contribute what you have been able to offer us over the past few years. You were born in Stockholm?
No, I was born in a little town in the middle of Sweden, Mariestad.
And how long did you stay there before you moved to Stockholm?
I took my student exam in Skara, one of the oldest schools in Sweden. And my student exam 1926. After that, I intended to be a surveyor as my father. We were six children, and in the education was rather expensive, which it wasn't if you went to the surveyor school. And to improve my merits, I went to Uppsala University to take some points, extra points in mathematics and biology. Due to military service, I came a little late to Uppsala, and visiting my first lecture in mathematics, I said to myself, this doesn't suit me. So I called my father and said, no, I go into the medical school.
And where did you go to medical school? At Uppsala?
I started in Uppsala, but after one term, I moved to Stockholm to the Karolinska Institute, where I took my exam 1935.
That was the exam to enter Karolinska Institute?
Yes.
As a medical student?
Medical school.
Now, the Karolinska Institute is the same as the Karolinska Hospital, or are they two different?
Two different. The hospital, as to say, belongs to the, it was a state hospital at that time. And it is very close to the Karolinska Institute in the same region.
I ask that question, of course, Torsten, because many people in the world recognize the name Karolinska Institute because that is where the Nobel Prizes in sciences and literature, I believe in economics, are also awarded from the Karolinska Institute and the committees therein. But therefore these are institutions that have been there for quite some time, well into the 19th century, weren't they?
That's right. The Karolinska was not the oldest medical school in Sweden, that was Uppsala. Right.
So when did you graduate from medical school?
1935.
1935.
Yes.
And what did you do after you graduated?
Well, my intention was to be a surgeon. So I had some locums in surgery in the hospitals in Stockholm. And then I had 1 year of surgery in Örebro, one of the greater towns in the middle of Sweden.
Yeah.
And after that, I came to Serafimer Hospital, the university clinic in Stockholm. 1937, I came there.
And how long did you continue in surgery? Obviously, you went elsewhere after that.
Together, I have 3 years of surgery. And at Serafimer Hospital, I was the youngest surgeon on the staff as a resident. And the youngest surgeon, he had the task to, for half a year, give anesthesias to all the professors' operation without knowing much about it. He had to empirically learn himself, and especially from experienced operating nurses.
Is that the way most of anesthesia was being provided throughout Sweden at the time?
Yes.
Were there any full-time physician anesthesiologists in Sweden at this time?
No. Mm-hmm. And this man, the youngest surgeon at the university, was called the dropper after drip on the mask.
Yes.
And after six months, a new man came. After 6 months, a new man came. All wanted to get rid of these 6 months to finish the surgery. So the level of anesthesia was staying like that. No progress, no interest. Hmm.
So what led you to transcend that level of no interest? How did you get interested? How did you get committed to a full-time career in this field?
Well, it's a rather dramatic story, which I may tell. Swedish surgeons in the 30s started to travel to America, to England, where the specialty anesthesia was already developed. And when they came back, they wrote in the reports that they were much impressed by the anesthesia service in those countries. On the other hand, foreign surgeon came to Stockholm and Sweden and was very much impressed by the surgical standard, but not of the standard of anesthesia. So my chief surgeon, Professor Gustav Söderlund, he saw the advantage of having a specialist in anesthesia. So he asked me if I would be interested to devote myself there. Maybe he saw and felt that I had some interest in my work as I'm giving anesthesia, and maybe he had some talents for it or something. I said, I'd like to be a surgeon. I said, I'll think it over. And I went on with my surgical training to the orthopedic institution to get a year orthopedics. Then a plastic surgeon, the first plastic surgeon in Sweden, Alan Ramnell, came back from England, where he had got his training. And we came back, he said, I can't do my work if I don't have an anesthesia specialist. An intubation wasn't done in Sweden during anesthesia. And one day he called me, summer day 1938, and said, a famous surgeon from St. Thomas's Hospital in London is in Stockholm. You should call him. I called him, his name was Michael Norsworthy. I called him up at his hotel and arranged to have lunch with him outside Stockholm. At that time, I had a Packard Roadster, model 1928, bought for 400 crowns, and with mechanical brakes. When I came to a circle, a truck stopped in front of me right away. And I rushed in that. The water was running out. That was the end of my car and the end of my surgical career. Because talking to Noseworthy for hours, he explained what anesthesia was, what could be done for the patients, for the teaching, for the research. And I right away saw this must come. And I went up. We were 15 years behind in Sweden. I saw right away. And I went up to my professor, Gustav Söderlund, and said, this is necessary. I'll do it.
So, having decided that you would go into anesthesia instead of continuing surgery,
yeah.
How did you then decide where you would go to get trained in anesthesia?
Well, Noseworthy was a wonderful man. He advised me to go to Ralph Waters in Madison, Wisconsin, which he was a friend of. It's better you go there, because there you will work. If you go to England, you just watch. So he wrote to Ralph Waters, and I also write to Waters, and had a letter from him that I was welcome to be a youngest resident, $25 a month, lodging, food, and laundry free.
So when did you start there?
I went there in October 1938, of course, by boat.
And at that time, there were other people taking residency training?
In Sweden?
No, and in Madison, Wisconsin. There were other residents in training at the time?
Oh, yes. I was enormously absorbed with the work there and found that I had come to the Mecca of anesthesia. Mm.
This, of course, was the first amongst the first, and I think, believe it was the first residency training program in the United States with Ralph Waters.
Yes, he started.
Who were some of the people in the program that the rest of us might know about that went on to fame and glory, such as yourself?
Yes, I have here a picture taken in Madison, 1939, and this is a group, you know, the pupils of Waters was called Droplets.
That's lovely. Water, the Waters droplets. Is Droplets. Where the
and every Easter, all his droplets gathered in Madison for scientific and social work. And I have here the picture from 1939. I'll show you. They have all been heads of departments all over the United States. And all. There is Barney Serkar from Bombay, India. He came there. Bill Castles, he became chief of Cook County Hospital in Chicago. Digby Lee, he became chief of the Children's Hospital in Los Angeles. Virginia Apgar, Presbyterian Hospital, New York. Hubert Hathaway, he came to California. Harvey Slocum, he later became a general surgeon in the Army, Washington. Mm. Bill Neff, San Francisco. Alan Conroy, Chicago and later California. Myself, and Taylor, I think he came to Pennsylvania. And there is M. Rubenstein from Bellevue Hospital, Waters himself, and Maurice Sievers, professor in pharmacology. There they are.
Lovely. When did you leave the training program? When did you finish the residency training program?
In April 1940. And before I went home, Walter gave me some names and addresses which I should visit. So I went...
In the States?
In the States, yeah. Before I left. So I went to California, Los Angeles, and met Charlie McCluskey, spinal anesthesia. And I have a list of all of them here. In Chicago, Bill Castles. I also met Dr. Korn at the airport, he who invented the pentatol. And Detroit, in Detroit there was no anesthetists, only nurses. Mm-hmm. That was before Paul Dump came there. Toledo, I studied nitrous oxide anesthesia with McKesson and Lamont and Clement. And in New York, of course, Rovenstein, Virginia Apgar, and in Philadelphia, Henry Root. He was continuous spinal, and he had a ward for hypothermia, too. Robert Ripps also there. Milton Peterson, Postgraduate Hospital in New York. And Ralph Tovell in Hartford. He used Curare in metrazole treatment for in psychiatrics. Paul Wood in New York, and of course John Lundy in Mayo Clinic, and Ralph Knight in Minneapolis. So when I left, I brought a bottle of American and the cream of American anesthesiology. Vintage 1940 back to Sweden.
Well, you certainly did get exposed to the cream of anesthesia in the 1940s. And when you came back to Sweden,
when I boarded Drottningholm on the way back to Sweden, two telegrams waited me on board.
One.
Best wishes for a pleasant trip from your friends at Bellevue, Camigan, Department of Anesthesia. And the other telegram, Waters droplets send fond au revoir, good sailing, best fortune to you and Swedish anesthesia vice presidents. Yeah. We had a club in Madison with four members, all our vice presidents. Barney Serker was vice president in housekeeping. Mm. He had a room at the university club. Digby Lee was vice president in entertainment. And Harvey Slocum, vice president in transportation, he had a car. And I was vice president in cuisine. I made Swedish food and glögg.
Well, then you went back to the Stockholm Institute.
Yes.
When you arrived back in Sweden.
The war was on, so but the Swedish port Drottningholm had alliance to go to cross the Atlantic. Mm-hmm. And I remember we went into the Norwegian town Bergen, where we left an American ambulance was about to go to Finland to help them there. And then we went into Gothenburg. The 8th of April, I arrived in Gothenburg. The 9th of April, the German invasion of Norway and Denmark occurred. And the next day, I'm very proud of the 10th of April, I have here the membership of American Society of Anesthetists, dated the 10th of April and signed by the Secretary Paul Wood. Number 751.
So then you returned to Stockholm and the Karolinska Institute and entered a career, yeah, during which you made so many contributions to anesthesia.
Yes.
But when did you meet your lovely wife, Ulla, who I enjoy her company just as much, Torsten, as I enjoy your company?
When I arrived, I stayed in my home family for a couple of days, and then went up to the Karolinska Hospital in Stockholm. It was new built, just opened, and went up to my chief there, Professor John Hellström, professor in surgery, because I belonged to the surgical department at that time. Mm-hmm. Professor Sjöström had arranged a position as anesthesiologist at Karolinska, which I got. I was the only who applied for it. And then I started Karolinska Hospital for, and in 35 years I worked there until I got emeritus. And you talk about how I met Ulla.
Yes.
The war was going on, and in June there was an extra course in surgery for the medical students. And there was a nice girl in that group with Ulla. And she was interested in anesthesia and respiratory physiology. So we found each other in the work and also fell in love and married in 1941. So we had a golden marriage last year.
Oh, lovely.
Yes.
And you had children?
Yes, we have four children. And I remember 1943, when our first child was on its way, we appreciated so much both the value of oxygen in anesthesia. So we decided if it will be a boy, we'll call him Syre, and that is oxygen in English.
In Swedish.
Yes. And we even get so far so we gave him a nickname, Oxy. But it happened to be a nice girl.
But eventually you did have a boy.
Yes, the next girl, and then the boy came, and he got as a third Christian name, Syre.
And did any of your children go into anesthesia?
Yes, the boy, Thorsten Jr., he is in anesthesia department in Uppsala, and now in charge of the pain clinic there, following his father's steps.
Well, I know you must be very proud of him, because he is certainly doing very well in academic anesthesiology, including the field of pain control.
Yes.
But in the 35 years between the time you returned to the Karolinska Institute and your retirement from active practice in 1975, what would you categorize as your major areas of contribution to the field? And certainly you made a major impact on anesthesia globally. How would you categorize these contributions?
As I said before, it was a standstill anesthesia. And I thought my primary work was to rise the level on a broad basis. And I followed my chief Ralph Waters' advice. First, the patient's safety without pain. Second, teaching. And third, research. And that had worked well. And there was no problem for me. I was had 3 years of surgery. The surgeons, I could speak the language, and they were all my friends. So I had never any difficulties with the surgeons. And when you had raised the level, the surgeons all over the country found that this was something. They sent their people, their residents, their nurses to Karolinska for me, for with paid salary from their home to me, to my apartment at Karolinska. So I had plenty of extra help.
You had plenty of extra help, but you also established standards of excellence for which you were widely recognized. So in recruiting people into anesthesia and elevating the standards,
yes,
You started off as the only anesthesiologist in all of Scandinavia, Norway, Finland, Sweden, and Denmark.
Yeah. Even continental Europe.
And continental Europe. And after 35 years, you had created a specialty that was recognized for its academic and intellectual excellence as a medical discipline. And this was all done by your teaching and by your attention to the patient care. But what areas in anesthesia were you particularly interested in?
From the beginning, I was alone at Karolinska. I had the youngest surgeon, as to be called a dropper. I had his help. Then I had nurses, the operating nurses had to help me too. And I had the students, they helped. And what do I say? The level of anesthesia has to be raised. And all these people who came from Sweden, Denmark, Finland, Norway, and even from Europe, came to Karolinska because that was the only teaching center existing after the war. We are lucky, so I could develop the department during the war as we stayed out.
But you were particularly noted amongst your fellow Swedes,
yes,
but also amongst British, American anesthetists and anesthesiologists for your contribution to the field of spinal anesthesia.
I was especially interested in spinal for one reason. As I was alone, you had to find a method which worked fast and safe. And the chief professor, John Hellström, he was also a urologist. Lots of urology where spinal was a method of choice. So I had to choose between epidural, spinal, or general anesthesia. But I had to find a method which worked safe and fast, and that was spinal. That's why we at Karolinska went in for this method.
One of the many contributions that you made in spinal anesthesia was offering the first rational explanation for the development of post-spinal headaches.
That's right. This belongs to the story. One day I told my assistant that in my room, on that shelf over there, you will find three boxes, glass boxes, in formalin. In one, you have a piece of the dura. After 2 days, this patient died after 2 days, not from the spine, but from his disease. And the other, a dura, 2 weeks old, after the spinal.
Both of these were 2 days and 2 weeks after spinal anesthesia.
After spinal anesthesia,
yes.
Yeah. And the third, 4 weeks.
4 weeks.
And I said to him, you take these boxes and make a histopathological investigation and we'll write about it. He did so. Frankson was his name. He basically became professor in surgery. And I think it was 1946 we published this, and it's now a classical, I think.
This was the basis for your observation that the hole in the dura,
yes,
was the primary cause for the postoperative headache following spinal anesthesia.
The leak through the hole.
Yes.
And I also showed that it takes at least 3-4 weeks for this hole to heal. Mm.
And you subsequently, therefore, reasoned that the smaller the needle, the lower the incidence,
yes,
of spinal headache would be.
So from the beginning, we used quite a large needle, 25 gauge. And then I saw a Professor Antoni, professor in neurology, doing a puncture of the neck of the back cisterna with a very fine needle. And I write, this is good for spinal anesthesia. So I introduced the fine needle. The frequency of headache went down from 10 to 3%. And now I think everybody will agree that the finer need you use, the less leakage, the less frequency of headache.
You also contributed the first, at least to my knowledge, the first prospective, objective, and statistically valid study of complications associated with spinal anesthesia that was published sometime in the late 1940s. Was this not the case?
Yes.
And what was the conclusion you drew from this study of the complications associated with spinal?
What complication do you mean?
Well, you had a paper on complications that included neurologic deficits and spinal headaches. And the conclusion, as I recall it, was that the neurologic complications were not nearly as frequent as people had previously.
Yeah, that's right. That was one of my assistants who wrote a thesis about complications of spinal anesthesia. Compared to another publication 10 years earlier, where they found that about 1 in 200 got complications in some form for spinal anesthesia. We couldn't understand that. So he did an investigation of all spinals during 1 year and found that we couldn't agree to that.
Towards the end of your active practice of anesthesia, you were a clinician. You were still giving anesthesia as a professor at the Karolinska Institute.
I preferred to be in the operating room more than to sit at the desk.
My congratulations. I agree with that wholeheartedly. But were you giving both general anesthetics as well as spinals?
Oh, of course.
Were you giving epidurals at that time?
It took too long time to give epidural. It didn't suit my temperament.
Fine. Would you say that the percentage of regional anesthetics at the Karolinska Hospital in the 1975 was primarily general anesthesia, or was it regional anesthesia, or what was the predominant type of anesthesia?
About 30% each. Local anesthesia, general anesthesia, and spinal anesthesia. But then, when the muscle relaxants came in the end of the 40s, by the way, I was the first who gave muscle relaxants in Sweden in 1946. Oh. It was the intercostrin. And that made that the frequency of high spinal anesthesia went down. We gave up the high spinal because complications during operation, hiccup, vomiting, and something like that.
Thurston, you were also involved in the introduction of both intravenous anesthesia as well as the introduction of lidocaine as a local anesthetic.
That's
right. Would you care to amplify on those 2 points?
Two Swedish chemists at the University of Stockholm developed xylocaine. It was called LL30. The 30th try was the best, and that became Astra's xylocaine. We tried that clinically from 1944 to 48 before it was released, and it became the worldwide used local anesthetic.
That was certainly a major innovation in
the
clinical practice of anesthesia, with the introduction of lidocaine. The intravenous anesthesia you were introduced to?
Intravenous, when I came back from the United States in 1940, a surgeon had developed a needle for heparin injections. And when I saw that, that was a gift from heaven for intravenous anesthesia. No one had used it for intravenous anesthesia before. It was a needle with a little rubber membrane where you could put the syringe needle in without puncturing the patient. The needle was permanent.
It had a rubber cap on the needle. Cap. Yes.
And we added at the end of the needle an opening where you could give fluid, blood, and intravenous fluid. So this needle, I think, was the original to all permanent intravenous needles. That was 1940.
And what local, what intravenous anesthetic were you using? Zolpidem? Hexobarbital?
No, it was, we were lucky that during the war, Astra made, we couldn't get pentotal from America. So Astra had made intravenous barbiturates with a called Narcotal. And that was a copy of the Swedish Önarkon, or the Swiss Önarkon. But later, they laid down the Narcotal and everybody went over to pentothal.
Do you have any suggestions to offer the neophyte student in anesthesia, the person who is in the practice of anesthesia, starting the practice of anesthesia, starting the training program? Do you have any sapient words of advice for that person?
Advice for the students?
Yeah.
Yes. I still, as an emeritus, have the honor to have an emeritus room at my department, and I also give seminars in the foundations of anesthesia and history of anesthesia. And some of them may be attached to follow the specialty. And to show the need for the specialty in Sweden, from the beginning I was alone, now we are over 1,000.
But once a person has started to go into anesthesia, do you feel that you can offer that person who has just started training in anesthesia any words of advice?
You mean which advice I can give him?
Yes.
Yes. I'll give him that this speciality is needed and you will find very much of interest in this specialty. Mm-hmm. It has a contact with most of the medical specialties on a broad basis. And it is a fascinating and stimulating work as anesthesiologist.
Well, thank you very much, Torsten. This has been a delightful interview. We thank you for your time and your attention. Thank you.